Yes.
On the occasion of 151st birth anniversary of the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi, Embassy of India brings to you Gandhi Katha by Dr. Shobhana Radhakrishnan. Dr. Shobhana Radhakrishnan is recognized for her invaluable contribution to literature, social service, and spreading vision of Mahatma Gandhi. She is the chief functionary of Gandhian Forum for Ethical Corporate Governance, formed under the aegis of the Standing Conference of Public Enterprises. Her Gandhi Katha and lectures on Mahatma Gandhi's vision and its relevance have made a mark all over the world and provide principles, ideas, and from the Mahatma's life that can help us in our quest for more significant substance and also help address pressing challenges of our times. Hope all of you will enjoy Gandhi Katha by Dr. Shobhana Radhakrishnan. Thank you.
Namaskar and welcome to the Gandhi Katha, story of Mahatma Gandhi narrated by me. During the commemoration of the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, which incidentally is also the 150th birth anniversary of Kasturba Gandhi, his wife, I express my deep gratitude to the Embassy of India in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, for hosting the Gandhi Katha to learn from Mahatma Gandhi's philosophy of truth, non-violence and purity of means, his spirituality, his practices of health and wellness of body, mind and spirit, for coping up and staying safe physically, mentally and emotionally, as well as spiritually, during and after the coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic, which has affected the entire humanity. In 2019-20, the Embassy of India in Riyadh had organized many activities and events to commemorate the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. October 2nd, the world celebrates the UN International Day of Nonviolence, and in India, it is celebrated as Gandhi Jayanti, the birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. The entire world is remembering Mahatma Gandhi, the apostle of peace and nonviolence. We have an opportunity to remind the humanity of the efficacy of the messages of Gandhiji, the father of our nation. I pay my respects to the leading lights of Saudi Arabia and convey my warm wishes to the people of Saudi Arabia and the Indian community. Gandhi Katha is based on the ancient Indian oral tradition of Katha, or storytelling with hymns and narration. I have given talks on Gandhi Katha in 94 countries during the commemoration of the 150th birth anniversary of Gandhiji in the past 2 years. I was invited by the Embassy of India in Riyadh to deliver talks in 2018 on the occasion of the UN International Day of Nonviolence. I addressed at the King Faisal Center, which was very well attended by diplomatic corps, Saudi officials and businessmen, including journalists and Indian diaspora. The second talk was at the International Indian School in Riyadh. In all the countries, people have great respect and reverence for Mahatma Gandhi. Many have been inspired by him to take up the cudgels against injustice through non-violence. Others have followed his environmental credo, and still others have been deeply touched by his simple spiritual life. The humanism of the world's thought leaders are so deeply reflected in Mahatma Gandhi's teachings. The new generation is eager to understand more about the greatest man of the last century, who made such a huge impact on humanity and inspired many world leaders. Today, in the field of international conflict resolution, people are interested in the effectiveness of peaceful means for ending disputes, as demonstrated by Mahatma Gandhi, compared with the use of force or violence. According to Saudi Arabia's permanent ambassador to the UN, Ambassador Abdullah Al-Maulami, he said that Saudi Arabia is committed to fundamental principles that are at the forefront of the task of building and maintaining peace. He said, and I quote, "My country asserts that the basic pillar of peace building and maintaining peace is achieving justice. Without justice, peace cannot flourish, even if periods of nonviolence prevailed. In peace building context, scholars and practitioners are seeking to integrate authentic indigenous and local cultural methods of conflict analysis and interventions. People are finding inspirations in Mahatma Gandhi's ideals and his lifelong efforts of peace building and conflict resolution through interfaith dialogue and harmony for communal unity. Saudi Arabia has also promoted a culture of dialogue, mutual understanding and tolerance internally and externally. Throughout his life, Gandhiji was engaged in finding solutions through these interfaith dialogues. Gandhiji had deep respect for world religions and developed lifelong friendships with people from different religions. He took time to study, reflect, and engage with different faiths and faith communities. During his lifetime, Gandhiji had read the Holy Quran more than once, and also he had read many books on Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It made a deep impression on him that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, often fasted and prayed, and that he had revelations not in moments of ease and luxurious living, but when he fasted and prayed, kept awake for nights together, and would be on his feet at all hours of the night as he received revelations. Mahatma Gandhi cultivated respect for Islam. To Gandhi, the central teaching of the Holy Quran remained that of peace. He regarded Islam as a religion of peace. He found Muslims to be brave, generous, and trusting. He sought to gain Muslim friendship through love. His ultimate remedy was to deal with the wrong, but not to hurt the wrongdoer. Thus, to him, the ultimate answer lay in the concept of live and let live, or mutual forbearance and toleration in life. He said that this is the lesson he had learned from the Holy Quran. Mahatma Gandhi used to start and end his day with prayers. In the ashram, every activity and program used to begin and end with prayers. And these prayers were from all the religions of the world. Gandhiji said that all the religions point to the same truth of compassion, forgiveness, tolerance, and love. Therefore, one should study and learn the essence of each of the religions in an attitude of humble friendship and with reverence to the people practicing all the different faiths. He said that this is the only way to come together in brotherhood and unity. Even after 7 decades of Gandhiji's passing on in every part of the world, his relevance is felt as strongly as ever before, and his vision and actions are of an enduring significance for all times and places. His approach to life was holistic and cannot be divided into watertight compartments of social, religious, political, and personal life. Gandhiji stands out as the champion not only of political democracy, but also of economic and spiritual democracy in today's world. Gandhiji believed that moral degeneration is the root cause of all evils, including conflicts. This explains his lifelong crusade of attainment of moral values such as truthfulness, nonviolence, purity of means, honesty, integrity, love, self-control, forgiveness, friendliness, compassion, and mercy, and so on. For Gandhiji, satyagraha, or nonviolent resistance in civil disobedience, was by non-cooperation with evil through the moral values of love force, truth force, soul force, suffering, and self-sacrifice. For him, the consideration for the suffering of fellow human beings was of paramount importance. His belief and actions that social change for establishing justice and dignity of humans is both less harmful and more sustainable when achieved by non-violent means. His legacy of satyagraha is now widely recognized the world over and seen in many moments for civil rights nowadays. Mahatma Gandhi's environmental practices were based on conservation of natural resources, which were often misused and overused for the sake of greed. Gandhiji had warned about the unsustainability on the global scale a century ago. Equality for women within the society was a principle Gandhiji was passionately involved in. His vision of Sarvodaya, the welfare of all, becomes very relevant in the crisis of internally displaced people, and migrants may well have been keeping in mind the very basic unit of human organization, a village or a county. His vision of Gram Swaraj, which is self-reliant, independent, self-governed villages built on the premises of sustainable growth, is the need of the hour. According to my understanding, Mahatma Gandhi's life was an epic of faith and endeavor. His faith was in truth, the ultimate reality of truth, and he endeavored to attain it through nonviolence throughout his life till the very last breath. Gandhiji's adherence to truth, nonviolence, and purity of means has inspired me to give Gandhi Katha so that people can put their hearts into understanding Gandhiji, get inspired to learn from his extraordinary ethical and moral leadership, his simple spiritual life, revolutionary thoughts, actions, his lifelong service to humanity against all forms of injustice, and how he continues to inspire people in all the parts of the globe at all times and in all ages. Perhaps the greatest source of strength for Mahatma Gandhi was in his faith in God. Truth was the deepest and the most complete form of God. The faith gave him the constant awareness that he was to be nothing but an instrument in his hands. He was to go wherever he was led. For him, the guidance of God constituted two things. One, he had to walk on the path enlightened by truth that was available to him in whatever measures and form. Two, he had to constantly gaze inwards and find inspiration through self-introspection, self-examination, and self-purification. And this he did by repeated questioning. And that question was, "Ko aham, who am I, what am I, and what is the real purpose of my life?" This question has been asked in our ancient Indian civilization since the past 5,000 years. The answer came to Gandhiji that the purpose of life was to serve others. The deeper the faith, the greater was the endeavor for Gandhiji. He said, "Truth is God." Faith in truth led Mahatma Gandhi to two other realizations. If God is omnipresent, then truth is omnipresent too. If each human being were an aspect of God, then each person is capable of truth, of being good and doing good to others. The second realization was that in spite of all the upheavals in the history of humankind, humanity will only progress in an auspicious direction, because truth, that is God, is only interested in the welfare of its creation. His endeavor throughout his life was devoted to the search of that element of truth, to awaken it and to nurture it. This is why he could feel oneness with everyone. For most of us, this realization does not set in easily. Because of this understanding of oneness, Gandhiji had no enemies. He did not want to settle scores with anyone, and he did not want to take any revenge. He merely wanted to extend his love, compassion and respect to everyone. That was one of his traits. He respected individuals as individuals, and that is another trait that we see in Gandhiji. Romarola, the French writer and pacifist who won the Nobel Prize for Literature, had written Gandhiji's biography in 1924, which introduced him to the world. And when he met him in 1931, he said, and I quote, "This little man is so fragile in appearance, is tireless, and fatigue is a word that does not exist in his vocabulary. He could calmly answer for hours without a muscle of face twitching. His mind proceeds through successive experiments into action, and he follows a straight line, but he never stops." I will play the Gandhi Katha hymn or dhun in Hindi that elaborates on Gandhiji's definition of truth as having harmony between thoughts, words and deeds. Man, vaani, karma mein satya hi bho. Man, vaani, karma mein satya hi bho. Jeevan mein mangal ke dwar hi bho. Jeevan mein mangal ke dwar hi bho. Gyan karm bhakti ka ho samyak vedan. Gyan karm bhakti ka ho सुंदर का सुमन Mahatma Gandhi's philosophy was primarily truth-centered. Truth was the first and foremost principle in Gandhian philosophy. Gandhiji's life was a continuous series of experiments with truth, and that is the name of his autobiography also, which the title is My Experiments with Truth. He applied his philosophy to his own life through selfless service and to practical social and political service through his non-violent civil disobedience campaigns, which he termed as Satyagraha. This is his first gift to humanity. To understand Gandhiji's thought and philosophy, one must understand him as a whole and not in parts. His thoughts on religion, education, economics, health, society, politics, literature, and culture, and in many other areas, need to be studied, understood and adopted according to the context. His life is filled with many kinds of challenges, solutions and achievements. He used truth as an experiment, not only in politics, but in his personal life too. Another aspect that gave him strength was the clarity that he had acquired from years of experiments and reflection on the philosophical content of Satyagraha. He was clear that Satyagraha was based on the principle of Advaita, of non-duality. If the same essence of soul encompasses all human beings, it would allow a Satyagrahi to become one with the oppressor. Any failure to touch and reach out to the opponent would be a failure of Satyagrahi and not a shortcoming of the philosophy of Satyagraha. Moreover, with the experience that he had had over the years, he had begun to see love as a very powerful and positive force. The challenge before him was to use this force with effect. The bigger the challenge, the more enthused Gandhiji was by it. Gandhiji realized that untruth, injustice, oppression and tyranny last only as long as their victims accept them. The moment one learns to say no to untruth and injustice, their edifice collapses immediately. This was true for the political, the economic and the social order. Mahatma Gandhi is the greatest apostle of peace the world has seen in the recent past. His notion of peace is focused on tolerance, love, forgiveness, compassion, oneness, truth force, love force, and soul force. Albert Einstein, the greatest scientist of the first half of the 20th century, had called Mahatma Gandhi as the supreme practical leader for change. He had said, and I quote, "I believe that Gandhi's views were the most enlightened of all the political men in our times. We should strive to do things in his spirit, not to use violence in fighting for our cause, but by non-participation in anything you believe in is evil." Gandhiji was the conscience keeper of humanity. That his ideas will be an inspiration to us both as individuals and as a society is beyond any doubt. He was an epoch maker, one who could sow the seeds for the next generation from the fruits of the previous one. Mahatma Gandhi is the most powerful visionary and a practical idealist from the first half of the last century, whose life is a role model for all of us. But the effort has to begin from the point where you are standing. That is what made all Mahatma Gandhi's idealist actions practical, and he can be truly called a man of action. But it does not only mean that he was very busy. That, of course, he was very busy. What we mean is the action of putting ideas or beliefs into practice more than anything else was the driving force in his life. The answer for Mahatma Gandhi was always found in action. He had said, "An ounce of practice is worth more than tons of preaching. Mahatma Gandhi has made significant and seminal contributions that span across such disciplines as economics, spirituality, conflict resolution, international peace, civil rights, education, politics, and much more. At that time, the most harmful and destructive impact on the world was that of imperialism, violence, war, materialism, and the greed for controlling the world. Mahatma Gandhi has advised to shun these seven social sins in his speech on October 22, 1925. Politics without principle, wealth without work, commerce without ethics, knowledge without character, pleasure without conscience, science without morality, worship without sacrifice. In my opinion, Mahatma Gandhi's life left the most powerful and strong imprint on the humanity of the world. He had said, "My life is my message," and that life is so transparent and open that anyone can learn from him. John Haynes Holmes was a pacifist, anti-war activist, and the founder of American Civil Liberties Union. He had met Gandhiji and found Gandhiji's presence, those bright eyes shining through his spectacles, his voice so clear and yet so gentle, his whole presence so simple and yet so strong. I believe that he is unquestionably the greatest man living in the world today, he had said. And he said, "When I think of Gandhi, I think of Jesus Christ." I will play the Gandhi Katha Dhun in Hindi, the hymn about Gandhi's philosophy of truth, non-violence, purity of means that combined in the form of satyagraha. Time magazine had listed out three most important protests over 190 years. The first one was Boston Tea Party. The second one was Dandi March or Salt Satyagraha. And the third one was the March of Washington. We can see a common thread. The first and second were against the same company, the East India Company. There is a common thread of non-violence in all the three. In 1930, with a pinch of salt, Mahatma Gandhi shook the world. He started out on 12th March from his Sabarmati ashram in Ahmedabad in Gujarat for Dandi with 79 fellow marchers, walked for 24 days, walking 10 miles a day, stopped at 48 villages, gave innumerable speeches, and the total distance he covered was 241 miles till he reached Dandi seashore on 5th April. In the early hours of the morning on 6th April, when he picked up a fistful of muddy lump of earth with salt, 100,000 people joined him. And towards the end of the campaign, 300,000 people broke the salt law all over India. 1,362 newspapers covered the news. William Lawrence Shearer, the American journalist, was present there and gave his graphic reporting of the salt satyagraha and brought the incidents to the notice of the world. So Gandhiji remains the most powerful global brand ambassador of peace and non-violence, a youth icon for resisting injustice, a man whose values can make the world a better place today. In 1904, in South Africa, after reading John Ruskin's book, Unto This Last, Barrister Mohandas Gandhi transformed his life and started leading a community life of self-control, voluntary poverty, and bread labor. He established 4 ashrams in his lifetime, 2 in South Africa, called Phoenix Settlement in 1904, and Tolstoy Farm in 1910, and 2 ashrams in India, Sabarmati Ashram in Ahmedabad in Gujarat in 1917, and the Sevagram Ashram in Wardha, Maharashtra in 1936. In Sevagram Ashram, Kasturba Gandhi and Mahatma Gandhi lived in poverty like the common villagers of India, and all the ashram community also lived like them. This was his ideal of a non-violent face-to-face society for Sarvodaya, the welfare of all, and carrying out constructive programs, which is his second gift to humanity. Gandhiji's ashrams had a mingling of political and spiritual aims. It was a practical laboratory for transforming ordinary men and women into extraordinary satyagrahis and seekers for offering the highest sacrifice of their lives in the freedom struggle on one hand, and to get involved in constructive programs to serve the poorest of the poor by establishing their self-respect and dignity. I'm happy to inform you that I was born in his last ashram, the Sevagram Ashram. My father was inspired by Gandhiji since his childhood and joined the non-violent freedom struggle and lived in the Sevagram Ashram. The life and thoughts of Mahatma Gandhi are intertwined and inseparable. His politics was imbued with his spiritual experiments, and his spirituality was tempered by his vision of a non-violent society, and his constructive work was integral to his politics. The unique practices of Mahatma Gandhi, his control of palate, his fasts, his spinning, his silence, and his prayers gave him the internal strength which were as much a part of his politics as of his spiritual life. These practices and experiments were sustained and nurtured by the inmates of the ashram community that he had founded. The ashram community, through its own practices, affirmed, modified, and validated Mahatma Gandhi's ideals and practices, and continues to do so even till today. This shows the relevance of his practices. Gandhiji carried out his experiments in health and wellness through nature cure, diet control, hydrotherapy, sun bath, mud packs, and observing silence for one whole day. The ashram inmates participated in this willingly. Gandhiji has given 3 gifts to humanity. The first one is satyagraha, the second one is constructive programs, and the third one is ekadashabrata, or the 11 observances, which were a set of rules for the ashram inmates for spiritual progress and voluntary self-control. Ivan Illich, the Croatian-Austrian philosopher, had come to Sevagram Ashram in 1980, and he stayed there for 1 week. Every day he used to sit in Bapu Kuti, or the cottage where Mahatma Gandhi lived. It was a very simple structure made from locally available material. And Ivan Illich said, and I quote, "This hut of Mahatma Gandhi demonstrates to the world how the dignity of the common man can be brought up. It is also a symbol of happiness which we can derive from practicing the principles of simplicity, service, and truthfulness." Now I will play the Gandhi Katha hymn, which explains Gandhiji's philosophy of truth is God.
आंखें पवित्र राख सत्य ही तू बोल, आंखें पवित्र राख सत्य ही तू बोल, ईश्वर साक्षात होंगे अंतर टटोल, ईश्वर साक्षात होंगे अंतर टटोल, सत्य ही है परमेश्वर बापू का वो, सत्य ही है परमेश्वर बापू का वो, उसी परमेश्वर की नित्य कर तू शोध, उसी परमेश्वर की नित्य कर तू शोध, आंखें पवित्र राख सत्य ही तू बोल, आंखें पवित्र राख सत्य ही तू बोल, ईश्वर साक्षात होंगे अंतर टटोल, ईश्वर साक्षात होंगे अंतर टटोल, ईश्वर साक्षात होंगे अंतर टटोल।
दो गांधी जी रोल एंड कंट्रीब्यूशन टू द पॉलिटिकल अरिना आर वेल नोन, व्हाट इज लेस नोन इज हिज कंट्रीब्यूशन टुवर्ड्स हेल्थ एंड वेल बीइंग। गांधी जी वॉज अ फर्म बिलीवर इन द प्रिंसिपल दैट अ हेल्दी माइंड keeps the body healthy, and he stressed the importance of a healthy lifestyle and positive thinking. His interest in health, hygiene, nutrition and diseases was as great as his interest in politics. He insisted that adopting preventive measures for diseases was better than treatment. He also said that it was important to focus on cleanliness, a controlled diet and an exercise regimen, and that it was best to avoid overconsumption of medicines, especially those that were not required. He was also a firm believer of nature cure and conducted experiments related to diet and fasting. He always believed that it was important to understand what caused diseases and then remove that very cause, rather than falling ill again and again and then attempting to treat it with excessive medication. Gandhiji was essentially a man of science. He approached problems in a scientific manner. Mahatma Gandhi's message to the world on the vital question of health and well-being is very important. To him, the study of this question was part of the service to God and his creation, which was his mission. Knowing to care summed up his life. His message was simple and easy to follow. It encouraged everyone to respect simplicity, voluntary self-control, reduce the wants, follow the tradition, cultural practices, the values, the environmental credo, and treat oneself through nature cure for living in harmony with nature. Gandhiji was very interested in health and wellness and remained ever vigilant about his own health as well as of others. He said that our lifestyle should be such that it should not let any disease come anywhere near us, and every person is responsible for looking after his or her body, mind, and spirit impeccably. He advised that in order for keeping physically, mentally and spiritually healthy, we should have perfect understanding of our bodies, which is made up of the five elements that are found in nature. And that is what has been told by our ancient seers and sages in India. And these five elements are air, water, fire, earth and space. For the wellness of our bodies, the balance and harmony between all these five elements is necessary. During the COVID-19 pandemic, enveloping ourselves in the rhythms and forms of nature can be transformative and healing. Ayurveda, the ancient healing tradition of India, recommends spending time in nature each day. Doing so allows us to experience the wonderment of this existence with all our senses. Nature allows us to shift our attention beyond the domain of our ego and to recognize that we are all inextricably connected to the universe. From the mind-body perspective, Mahatma Gandhi's standpoint was that health is an optimal integration of body, mind, soul, and the environment. Environment is our extended body. Yoga and meditation integrate all components of health, and Gandhiji was a strong believer in nature cure, Ayurveda, and practiced Ashtanga Yoga as well. His experiments with nature cure were always on himself. He advised his friends and disciples to follow these remedies and treated and cured 30,000 patients through nature cure. Very few people know that as a couple, Gandhiji and Kasturba Gandhi contributed immensely 123 years ago to public health emergencies, working as frontline workers and treating patients in the service of humanity. During the Second Anglo-Boer War from 1899 to 1902 and in the Zulu Uprising of 1906 in South Africa, he established the Natal Indian Ambulance Corps, along with 300 free Indians and 800 Indian indentured labor, and served as stretcher bearer. In the bubonic plague outbreak in Johannesburg in 1904, he and Kasturba Gandhi rushed to help the Indian indentured labor, quarantined the patients in an empty godown after thoroughly cleaning and sanitizing it, and treated some of them through Nature Cure. Gandhiji and Kasturba Gandhi returned to India in 1915. And in 1918, there was an outbreak of Spanish influenza pandemic. So Gandhiji opened up his Sabarmati ashram as a quarantine center and treated and served patients through Nature Cure, provided simple vegetarian diet to boost immunity and maintain physical distancing. Both of them took care of the families of the patients, looked after their physical, mental, and spiritual needs, gave them correct information, and helped them in remaining positive through prayers, meditation, chanting of Ramanama, and taking care of each other during the time of the Spanish flu pandemic. Gandhiji had said on 10th November 1918 that our ancestors could build such tough bodies in the past. But today, we are reduced to a state of miserable weakness and are easily infected by noxious germs moving about in the air. There is one and only one really effective way by which we can save ourselves from them, even in our present broken state of health. That way is the way of self-restraint and of imposing a limit on our acts, wants, and desires. In August 1942, Gandhiji wrote the book titled Key to Health, in which he wrote that anyone who observes the rules of health mentioned in this book will find that he has got in it a real key to unlock the gates leading him to health. He will not need to knock at the doors of doctors or vaidyas or the traditional health practitioners from day to day. Today, the world is facing three kinds of crises globally. First is the coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic. The second one is the serious and long-drawn financial crisis. And the third one is the ecological crisis, which is impacting everyone. We have to look for answers somewhere within ourselves by learning from the life of Mahatma Gandhi, who had said, "My life is my message." The lesson the pandemic is teaching us is simple. When one member of the family falls sick, the entire family is affected, and soon the community is affected, and the nation is affected, and then other communities in other nations in this globalized world. The well-being of one individual has an impact on people on the other side of the globe. This is true of every action of ours: what we eat, what we buy, what we think, and what we do has reverberations and repercussions on all life on earth. It is this anubandha, this interconnectedness, that sustains all life on earth. We are all in this together as one human family, as brothers and sisters. Whether we choose to see it or not, we only have one home, this planet Earth, our Mother Earth. The current COVID-19 pandemic is a wake-up call for every country, big or small, rich or poor, developed or developing. It has opened our eyes to the fragility of the existence of humans. Our ancient sages and seers from India have always looked upon us as Vishwamanava, or the global citizens, and said that the world is one family, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Many lessons are very clear, and some are still unknown, surrounding us in uncertainty. This uncertainty is causing mental stress, anxiety, existential crisis, fear of extinction and death, and the mass psychology of living in depression and grief is pointing out towards this fact in the current pandemic. We are collectively grieving for the loss of our known lifestyle. When a crisis makes you feel stressed, meditation, prayers, chanting relieves the stress response. And when the stress keeps repeating itself without let up, the thinking mind reacts to all of these conditions. It always has, even in normal times. But a crisis brings stress into high relief, making it very capable of lowering the immune system and causing inflammatory diseases. Decades ago, stress was classified as an epidemic of modern life. The Gandhian way of life is the best guide to practicing the coping mechanism that induces relaxation, calmness, inner peace, absence of anxiety, and remaining positive. So Gandhiji comes out as the greatest healer and the wellness guru who comes free of cost. Gandhian principles of freedom from fear and care for all is a perfect prescription in the times of COVID-19 pandemic. Gandhiji's emphasis on healthy lifestyle, empowerment for self-care and care in the community would make perfect sense. I once again take this opportunity to thank the Indian Mission for hosting the Gandhi Katha. My special thanks to all of you who have joined me online today. I will end with the Sanskrit shloka, which is the peace benediction for the universal welfare. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah, Sarve Santu Niramayaha, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashchit Dukkha Bhag Bhavet. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shantihi. Let all be happy, let all be healthy, let all experience auspiciousness, let no one be overwhelmed by grief. Om Peace, Peace, Peace. With Gandhiji's blessings, who had said that peace is the only positive force which will lead us from darkness towards light, I will end the Gandhi Katha with the hymn or dhun, Shubha Mangal Ho. Mangal Ho, Shubha Mangal Ho.